about the natural vegetations of India. Okay, by definition, natural vegetation means the plants that grow naturally around you without any human aid. Means these types of the vegetation are not being grown by the human, but it is growing naturally in the surrounding forest, in the pastoral land or any marshy portions of our India. Okay, so the natural vegetations of our India can be divided into 5 types. Number 1 is the tropical evergreen forest. Number 2 is the tropical deciduous monsoon type of forest. Then we have the tropical desert forest. Then we have the mountain forest or Himalayan vegetation. Then we have the littoral forest or mangrove vegetation. Okay, so I'm going to start with the number 1 point, that is tropical evergreen forest. The tropical evergreen forest, we found this specifically in the regions where the rainfall is very high. Examples like ebony, then we have mahogany, chaplas, etc. These types of the trees are very good for making furniture. Okay, next is the characteristics of this tropical evergreen type of forest. Okay, number 1, it grows in the region where the temperature ranges between 25 to 27 degrees Celsius and have an annual average rainfall of about or above 300 centimeter. These trees are specifically hardwood varieties of trees and have broad leaves. This broad leaves actually forms canopy and it don't allow the sun to penetrate or the sunlight to penetrate and reach the surface of the places. As a result of that, what is happening? The place the surface portion of this forest are very much moist and contains a lot of insects and poisonous plants also. Next, these are very much high height have of they have a height of 60 meter. Okay, this types of forest we specifically found in the regions of our Western Ghats. Then we have in the northwestern part of our India, the states that fall under this type of the forest are like western part of Maharashtra, Western Ghats, then we have the Andaman Nicobar Islands, then we have the Meghalaya, Assam portions and Nagaland. Okay, so next is the tropical deciduous or monsoon type of the forest. This type of the forest are found in the regions where the rainfall is not very high, about 100 to 150 centimeter. Okay, example of this type of the trees are sandalwood, deodar, etc. These trees are used for the firewood supply and also for making of the doors and windows. Okay, characteristics of this type of the trees are, number 1 is that they shed their leaves during the dry season. Why they shed their leaves during the dry season? To reduce the amount of transpiration that occurs from the leaves. Okay, next is that they have a height of about 35 to 40 meter. Okay, so these types of the trees are found in throughout all over India. In the states falling under Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, then we have the West Bengal region. Okay, in the map you see the light shaded portion of green. This total green portion actually covers the region of tropical deciduous forest. Okay, next is the tropical desert forest. Okay, the trees that are fall under this type of are thorny bushes, babul, cacti, and these are used for fencing purpose in the desert region. Okay, characteristics of this type of forest are, they grow in the region where the temperature is very high and have an annual average rainfall about 25 to 50 centimeter. From this you can understand that how less amount of the rainfall this vegetation receives, and as a result of that the growth of the trees is not very much developed. Okay, these trees have a partial or complete loss of the leaves. They don't have the leaves. The leaves are being modified into thorns so that they can check the loss of the water through transpiration, and also they have a waxy covering in the portion of their trees. Okay, then they have the long roots. Why they are having the long roots? Because they receive, as I told earlier, that the rainfall is about 25 to 50 centimeter, which is quite less. Okay, for survival purpose, these trees need water, and to get the water, they are need to grow a long roots. Why? Because the maximum amount of the water that they get it from the underground level of the water or groundwater. Okay, and the groundwater layer is present at a far, far below from the surface level from where these trees are growing. So they need to grow long roots. Okay. They also have a thick fleshy stems. Why? This in this thick fleshy stems, they actually store the water during the for survival during the period of drought time. Okay. Next, we have the mountain forest or the Himalayan vegetation. Okay. The trees that falls under this types of the vegetations are teak, bamboo, oak, maple, etc. Okay, and these trees are specifically used in that type of the trees used for the paper industry region, matchsticks region, and are this from this different types of the tourism industry is also grown over there. Because of the scenic beauty, the coniferous trees have a very scenic beauty over there. Then the tourism industry is developed on those part of the region. The mountain forest can be specifically divided into three types based on the altitude. Okay, let us divide the mountain forest. As you can see in the map, that the mountain forest present in the total is covering the total Himalayan zone of our India. Okay, so we divide the Himalaya into two portions, like the Western Himalaya and the Eastern Himalaya. So let us divide the Western Himalaya and the Eastern Himalaya portion. So, Himalayas, I'm dividing into two parts. One is Western, another is Eastern. Okay, this Western Himalaya or the vegetation of the Western Himalayas is being divided into three parts. One is the pine belt, then we have the coniferous belt. Next, we have the alpine meadows. Okay, the pine belts we found at a height between 1000 to 2000 meter altitude. Okay, then we have the coniferous belt. We found this in the height between 2000 to 3000 meter. And the trees that grow over here are deodar, spruce, fir, etc. Okay, next we have the alpine meadows. This ranges between the height of 3200 to 5000 meter, and here the flowering plants grows like the rhododendrons, then we have the juniper, then we have orchids. Okay, the Eastern Himalayan vegetation is again been divided into four parts. Number one is the terai belt. Terai means this portion, like we have the mountains over here, the below portion of the mountains, like the lowermost portion or the foothills portions of the mountain, we are including this into this terai vegetations. Okay, like this lowermost part of the mountain belt. Okay, all the lowermost part of the mountain belt we are falling or categorizing it under this terai belt. Okay, this terai belt extends for about 3000 meter from the foothills region, and we get the trees like shishu, gorjan, bamboo over here. Next, we have the after terai belt, we have the evergreen trees at the altitude between 1300 to 2700 meter, and here the trees like maple, then oak grow over here. Okay, after evergreen, we have the coniferous belt, that is between 2700 meter to 400 meter in altitude, and the trees like fir, deodar present over here. And the last division is our alpine meadows that exist between 4000 to 5000 meter altitude, and we have the same flowering plants over here along with the pasture lands. Okay, so with the help of these trees, what industries are being developed? Raw materials. These trees actually supplies the raw material for the paper industry, matchsticks, etc. Then the last one is the littoral forest or the mangrove vegetations. Okay, examples like the Sundari, Gordan, Hogla, etc. All these trees are being used for the making of furnitures, then for the wheels of bullock carts, boats, etc. Okay, characteristics. These trees we basically found in the region where we have the tidal forest or the delta region of all the rivers of India. So rivers means specifically the riverine valleys like Ganga, Brahmaputra, then Mahanadi, then we have the Kaveri, Godavari delta, etc. Okay. These trees have the breeding roots or the pneumatophores. Why? Because they grow in the saline soil. In the saline soil, it is very difficult for the roots to breathe under this. So they grow up above the surface and grow as this breathing roots or the pneumatophores. Then we have the, they have the stilt root to give support to the plants. Then they have they are also known as the tidal forest and have leaves throughout the year like the evergreen forest. Okay, so this is actually the total part covering the different characteristics of the natural vegetations that we found specifically in India. Okay, now come please everyone, come to the page number 101. Okay, why we need to conserve the forest, or why are the measures to conserve the forest. Okay, so number one for conservation of the forest is that they actually control and bring the rainfall. For this purpose we need to conserve the forest. Then they prevent the soil erosion by holding the soil firmly. Then they improve the fertility of the soil. How they are improving the fertility of the soil? By providing the manure that is required for regaining the fertility. Then we have there some of the plants also gives the medicinal herbs from where the medicines are being bring. They supply the valuable timber, then firewood for the purpose of cooking and also for the purpose of making of furnitures, then making of doors, windows, etc. Okay. The wildlife are very much dependent on this forest, because the forest is actually the home of the wildlife. If we are disrupting or cutting out the forest region, it is affecting or the home of the wild animals are getting affected. Okay, so there are some measures which have been adopted to conserve the forest. Okay, there are total amount, there are lots of points under this, so please read any 5 points from this heading portion. Okay, so number one is the prohibition of discrimination of the deforestation. So what is this saying? The number one point is saying is that we should prohibit deforestation. Why we should prohibit deforestation? Because deforestation means cutting off the trees. If you are cutting off the trees, we are clearing away the land, then the homes of the wild animals is going, then the soil of that region is becoming loose and it is provoking the soil erosion. Again, the rains are also being affected by this, because as I told earlier that forest also helps a great amount in causing our rainfall or in bringing rainfall. Okay, next is the reduction of felling of the premature trees. Why we should not cut the premature trees? Because they are not fully grown or mature. Okay, so if we are cutting up the premature one, which are already in the growing stage, we are actually hampering the growth stage of any of the plants, and as a result of that this plants cannot be utilized fully also. For example, if I am cutting a tree like a deodar tree, okay? If the hardwood or the furniture from which the mahogany tree, okay? So mahogany trees have been used for the production of furniture, okay? The trees that are required to do the production of the furniture is a very hardwood variety, and hardwood varieties develops at that point of the time when the tree becomes totally mature, okay? So if we are cutting away the immature trees, what will happen? It is actually hampering the furniture industry. How it is hampering the furniture industry? The hardness that is required to make the furniture is we are not getting it from that immature trees. Okay, as a result of that, the furniture that we have been producing is also not very much good in quality. Okay, next, use of alternate source of energy instead of fuel. So we should use the alternate source of energy for the cooking. As you know, specifically in the rural Indias, most of the household activity or cooking of the household belongs to this, or do the cooking with the help of this firewood variety only. So firewood varieties means they are cutting off the trees to taking it to their home and they are burning it and cooking the food on that fire. Okay, so if they are cutting up the trees, they are not they are not categorizing the tree. They are cutting it in a haphazard manner. Okay, so when they are cutting it in a haphazard manner, they are clearing it the most part of the land or most part of the forest land or most part of the vegetation zone. So this is hampering the overall environment or overall zoning or overall climatic conditions of a place also. Then we have the points like the prevention of the forest fire. Forest fire should be prevented, okay? Because if once the forest fire, as you have seen in the examples of the Amazon forest fire that occurred during the last year, so you have seen that for how many longer period of the time we have this forest fire, and to almost half of the portion of the Amazon is being cleared out or being totally burned down because of the forest fire. Okay, it's not only affecting the natural vegetations, it is also affecting the livelihoods of the animals that are living over there, the herbs that are growing over there, the small flowering plants that are growing over there. All this have a very much good effect on all of this are actually helping in maintaining the ecological balance of our world. Okay, so the forest fire, if the outbreaks of the forest fire occurs, it is going to burn down the whole region. Okay, and it is not possible by the human to stop this within an hour or two. So once it starts, it will last for a longer period of the time, and when the forest burns, it is actually hampering the total ecological system or ecological structure of this particular region. Okay, next we have the controlling of the grazing of the cattle. In India, villagers bring their cattle or the goats into the forest for the grazing purpose. This by when they are taking these animals for the grazing purpose, they actually acts as a hindrance for the regeneration of the forest land. Okay, they are eating up all the saplings of the trees or saplings of the plants and all, are not allowing it to grow. Okay, as a result, what is happening? It is affecting the total vegetation of that region. So the grazing of the cattle should be strictly prohibited. Okay, then we have the afforestation and the reforestation. Afforestation and reforestation means planting of the trees in those regions where we have cleared away all these trees, and replanting with the seedling trees, we can grow or ensures the growth of the soil. Growth of the plants over there. By growing the plants will grow the roots. These roots will help and retaining the soil. By doing the afforestation and the reforestation, we can not only we will help in maintaining the ecological balance, but we can also help in retaining the soil in the particular region and not allowing the soil to be eroded away by any natural agents. Okay. Next, we have different adaptation of the forest management, like felling and the cutting of the trees. Like there should be some management or the management or say categories must be marked in the forest. Based on that, you can do or carry out this felling or cutting of the trees. For example, you should cut away the mature, means all the mature varieties of the trees should be marked first, and that trees should be cut first, okay? And then we have the premature, which should be left aside for the growing period, okay? If we do so in this manner, then we can maintain the balance. Like if we are cutting up the haphazardly full forest, then what will happen? There will be no plants left to maintain it or for the regeneration of the forest of that particular region, okay? So if you are categorizing the trees according to the best of varieties, then it will help to maintain the region. Okay, next we have the people participations. Like people can participate also in the protection of the forest. Okay, next we have the social forestry and agroforestry. So this social forestry and agroforestry is very much important, and it often comes in the question, what is social forestry or what is agroforestry? It both comes for short questions and also comes along with the long questions also. Okay, what is social forestry? It has been started by the National Commission on Agriculture in 1976. The main aim of this project is to plant trees in the fallow and the wasteland, okay, in order to remove the pressure from the traditional forest, okay, like planting of the trees around the agricultural fields, then around the railway lines, roadsides, etc. The social forestry actually aims to provide the common man with the timber, fuel, fodder, wood, etc. Okay, if we are doing this social forestry surrounding our say railway lines, then surrounding our agricultural fields, so no more need to cut away the forest will be required. Okay, whatever timber is required or whatever wood is required, we can get it from the social forestry region also, keeping aside the main forested part of India. Next we have the agroforestry. What is agroforestry? Agroforestry is actually the raising of the trees and the agricultural crops side by side. Like we have a plot like this, agricultural plot. So here we are growing up the agricultural crops, and surrounding this agricultural plot of land we are planting the trees. Okay, so this will again reduce the pressure on the forest, okay, and it will also helps or also restrict the clearing away of the forest too. This agroforestry is being done in the region inside the forest, where of some fallow or a leftover land is left, so there the agriculture is going on, and in the side of the forests are present. Okay, so these are specifically found in the region of Kerala, then we have the Tamil Nadu, etc. So up to this is the your natural vegetation portion. So please go through the chapter or go through this everything very well. Okay, and the probable questions that we get from here is that long questions on how we can conserve the forest, then the difference between social forestry, agroforestry, or what is social forestry, what is agroforestry. Then we have this, as I told, this characteristic natural vegetation. All this you can get the short questions over there for 2 months or 3 months, like examples of the tropical desert forest or example of tropical evergreen forest. Then what are the uses of tropical evergreen forest trees, uses of this then desert forest trees, etc. Most probably you are going to get from this portion is short question type answer, not long question. I don't think comes from this characteristic portion. The long question that usually comes over here is based on the methods of conservation, and then we have this social forestry, agroforestry. Okay, the map point that we have is there, the mountain forest region, or select the tropical deciduous forest or desert vegetation or mangrove vegetation like this. Okay, thank you very much.